Hi everyone, welcome to another live. Today I'm super excited. We're gonna be joined by Pasha Hajian, student I met this summer, and he's actually in his past life, he was a sports agent, which is super cool. It's something that's like, you only read about in the news. I mean, I'm a soccer fan, I've always seen stories about sports agents, and I'm like, how do you get to be a sports agent? So thank you for Pasha for joining us. I'm gonna play, I was thinking what song to play for sports agency song, and I got this Chumbawamba song that used to be the soundtrack for a FIFA something, 98 or something. So enjoy the song while we get Pasha on. Perfect. All right. Hi, Pasha John.
How you doing?
Good, man. How are you? Happy Tuesday.
Everything good. Thank you. I appreciate it. No, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
You look so professional and well put together.
Thank you. No, I appreciate it. I think it's lagging.
I hear you okay. Do you have problem hearing me?
It's like repeating our voices again.
Oh, got it. Let me disconnect headphones. Let's see if it's better. Okay. How about now? You may hear my wife.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you totally perfectly.
I think it worked.
Yeah, folks who are watching, if you hear us okay, please drop us a note. If you have sound issues, please let us know. Sometimes we can't tell. Pasha John, you said you just got home. Where were you, if I may ask?
No, just had a meeting. So, yeah, just a meeting that I just got back home.
Nice. How's law school going?
Law school in this day of age is unfortunate. You know, it's not what we're human beings. We're all sociable, you know, and to lack that and not to be alongside my colleagues is tough. But everything is a learning experience, and I think this is something maybe to get adapted for the future, maybe for the bar, you know?
Yeah. And especially for you, like, from little I know from you, from the few interactions we've had, and your background as a sports agent, like, you probably, like, your natural environment is being out in a group, talking to people. Like, it's all about relationships and networking for you, so I assume it's been challenging.
Yeah, I mean, in the football world, it's pretty much who you know, how you get it. And for me, it's been a humbling experience, to be honest, working with, you know, Iranian players. That's a market I know. That's a market that I've been dealt with for the past couple of years. But I would say pretty much this past year, I've been working more full time on top of law school. But it's all networking, you know, and it's harder for me, as you could imagine, because I'm younger. But I think one thing that has been so humbling for me is to see other bigger agents in this industry that I would never thought I would even have a word with, that they contact me for different projects and everything. And now everything is through Zoom. But I've been in someone that, like, growing up, that everything, I got to take it day by day and learn, you know. And so it doesn't matter how many years I have now or the future, but I just want to keep learning. And so it's been humbling.
That's awesome. So, Pasha, Facebook stalked you a little bit, and I have a theory. And you tell me if the theory is true.
Okay.
You have so many pictures with different players from back in the day, and, like, you went to so many games. So my theory is that you actually, like, you love this world so much and hanging out with players and talking to people and meeting people that you kind of fell into the agent work just naturally. It wasn't, like, something you killed yourself to get to, it just happened.
Yeah, I mean, you don't grow up becoming an agent, right? And the way I got into this industry is really because of my relationship with the team medley players, Carlos Queros at the time. You know, I built a relationship with him. And people don't know he was the former head coach of the Iranian national team.
Yeah. So hold on. And, stop there. Yeah. How did you do that? Like, give us the story. That's amazing.
Yeah. I mean, there's something very personal to me, Ali, that I just don't want to share on the record of how it gave me a driving force. In 2014, in summertime, I realized that nobody talks about Iranian football. And I created a project called Gold Azan Podcast that became the first ever international podcast on Iranian football in English. We know about our football, but nobody else knows.
Right.
And unfortunately, the people that do talk about our football, they make it very political. And it's not a really good spectrum. So I created a platform to get people that were interested a door into the door. And through networking and meeting the coaches, you know, it created a pathway for me that agents were saying that, Pasha, if you have already, why don't you work in this industry? And I started getting more immersed into it. Team medley players were contacting me for help and everything. And I was becoming more of an intermediary between the player lives and between the players, coaches, and, you know, the clubs. And Carlos Queros, as you can imagine, working for the Iranian Football Federation, unfortunately, they couldn't pay finance him to go to London or visit these players wherever they might reside. Yeah. So I used to set up the meetings behind the scenes for the coach.
Yeah.
And when I met more people, they said that, Pasha, if you're going to law school, why don't you become a sports agent? So I got my license through the U.S. Soccer Federation. And I've met so many people within this industry, not just Iranian people, just different ethnicities and stuff still contact us. But there's so much I could do because I'm still in school. Yeah. But I keep saying it's been a humbling experience because when you learn about different backgrounds of people and what they're going through and you want to, you know, open a door for them, you learn more about yourself as a human, not as professionally, but just as a student of the game.
You said so much. I'm taking notes because there's a few things I would love to know more about. So first, the Golbezan podcast. How long did you do that for?
I do help the guys right now off the record. If they need an interview with a player, I connect them and stuff. Yeah. But I started Gold Biz in 2014 from my college dorm room to I stopped pretty much behind the scenes in 2019, I would say.
Wow.
So 5 years, I would say.
So that's amazing. And then how long is the process to get become a licensed agent in the U.S.?
Yeah, the reality of it is you don't need to become a licensed agent. You could just be a business or lawyers. You know, some of them are not agents, but they represent players on contract issues. The way I got it is I have a personal relationship with Ernie Stewart, the general manager of the United States Soccer Federation. He was actually the person that brought Adir Zajan Bash from NEC Nijmegen to Azad Alkmaar. So because of my relationship with him, as soon as I told him to get into it, he signed me up. I didn't take an exam or anything, but you should technically. So, yeah. So it's all networking. It goes back to which it's all networking.
Yeah. Nice, man. So paint the picture. So 2014, you said you were in a college dorm. So where is that? Where'd you go to college?
University of Florida. So Florida. I actually, I'm based in Florida right now. And I attended the University of Florida for college, and I got bored of it. Now I'm in Davis for law school in California.
Got it. At what age did you move to the U.S., Pasha John?
I can't honestly say the age, but I think like early high school, I moved to the U.S.
Okay.
Yeah, and I attended Tehran International School in Iran. So,
wow.
That's just growing up in Iran. We didn't have a girlfriend, right? Because it was a men's school. Yeah. So our ball was a girlfriend. So yeah. From growing up from a young age, football has always been my passion, you know?
Yeah.
And I never thought I would get into this industry. It just happened, and so we'll see where it goes from here.
Let's back up. Was Tehran International School in, like, Farmania or Aghdasiya or close there?
It's in Saadat Abad.
Okay.
Majority of the students are actually, their parents are diplomats.
Right.
So, and because both of my parents are Iranian, I was not supposed to be part of the school. So as you could imagine, knowing people, because they said that one day I'm going to move back to the Sixers. I was actually born in Tampa, Florida.
Yeah.
So I got around it thanks to my father, you know. But at such a young age, I met so many diverse people, even North Korean kids, believe it or not. We had North Korean kids in our class. And now when I'm at this age, I realize why would they have always a fight with South Korean kids, you know?
Wow, so
It's
the
been amazing.
instructions are in English or Farsi?
Farsi was a second language, believe it or not, in middle school.
Oh, Pasha Hajian, you
taught in
froze
English.
For a second. Let's see. Hopefully we'll get you back.
Can you
Pasha
hear me,
Jan,
Andy?
You froze, so I'm going to X you out, and we'll try to pull you back in. All right, we're going to go back to our music until we get Pasha back. All right, we're getting Pasha back. I want to close the door real quick, folks. I'll be right back. All right, we're Pasha John, I think you can hear us. It says adding, so you're going to come back on in a second, hopefully. But wow, we used to live close by to the Tehran International School, and I remember the walls. It was like tall brick walls. Let's get Pasha in. Perfect. Pasha John, sorry we got disconnected.
Sorry, it keeps lagging. I think it's my Wi-Fi, unfortunately. Now it's much, much better. There's no, I was hearing both my voice and yours at the same time.
Oh, that's
so
annoying.
Thank you.
That happens to
yeah,
me
yeah.
sometimes.
So that's why I was hesitating a little bit, so I apologize.
No way. Okay,
it's
well,
perfect.
That happened the other day and I can't even focus. So the fact that you were
yeah,
able to focus even
yes,
is amazing.
You. This is perfect now.
So I was saying we used to live close by. We live in Ajuda, Indianapolis here, so we close
oh, okay.
We always, as a child, we drove by the international school and they had like tall brick walls. It's like very secluded. So I always remember as a kid like fantasizing like who's behind those walls. Like I wanna see these kids because we were
right,
so
right.
starved for like international diversity, and so it's
right.
amazing that you were on the other side of the wall.
No, of course. And what's interesting is Amir Abidzadeh, the son of the legendary goalkeeper Ahmed Abidzadeh. Now he's a national team guy. He actually started last week against Bosnia in his full debut. He was my classmate. And well, 1 year ahead of me, he's been a close friend of mine. And we were just talking about it the other day because I sent him a video. I visited Iran a couple of years ago that we went to school. He's like, how did you get this footage? I was like, they still remember us. You know, the security guard was still there, Alai Rahmani, and you know, it's like he became a professional football player, you know, and now I work off the pitch side. So we were just talking about different motives and we're like, we just all happened through the beautiful game at international school in Tehran. So it's been rewarding.
Well, that's a big topic we should talk about. That's beautiful. But if you don't mind, like, just tell me more about this. I'm just so fascinated, like being in Iran in the company, like you said, North Korean kids.
Yeah,
like I'm sure there were kids from Nigeria all over the world. Like, was cool? Was that really cool?
I'll be honest with you, Ali. When I moved to the States, believe it or not, because obviously being in a southern state, you know, being amongst different students were like, have you ever seen a black person? Have you ever seen a Spanish person? But they didn't know that I was already so exposed to diversity. And I was so fortunate enough at a young age to travel the world. Because if you imagine when you're in Iran, 3 or 4 hours, you're in Europe. But here it takes 6 or 7 hours straight from Florida to California directly, you know, and, you know, right now a close friend of mine, Sharon Noor, saw Dubai. His father was a diplomat from Sierra Leone. I talked to him daily on WhatsApp. We have a group chat with all the guys from Tehran International School. And, you know, being exposed at such a young age to these different diverse group of people and getting understanding them now after this talk, I'll send you a few pictures. I was always wondered why North Korean kids at the time always had an issue with South Korean kids. And every time I had a birthday party or my friends, they were not allowed to attend. And now being at this age, now I could understand why due to the politics or just the different cultural aspects of it. But I would say this, that everything that I've learned till this age, to be honest, Ali, I'm not just saying that, is through Iran. Because Iran taught me appreciate the small things you have in life, you know. And we are very fortunate to be living in this country. A lot of people wish we were living, we're in our shoes right now. And so at such a young age to be exposed to, you know, different, you know, classmates of mine that I'm still in touch with, you know, even some of my teachers, you know, it really shapes you, you know. And as I said, because only in college is when women and men are mixed. And so the only ball or anything we could get out of, you know, the whole political climate or anything was through a soccer ball, as you could imagine. And I always say, people ask, what's your religion? I say, I'm a pretty spiritual guy, but soccer is my religion, you know? And when you have that passion for the game, it's easier to, you know, speak to these players, you know, or talk to these clubs. And, you know, you don't grow up envisioning becoming an agent. I never actually, honestly, thought I would get into this industry. To even meet some of these high caliber players that I'm in touch with, you know, Mesut Ozil's agent and all these, you know, big time players, and for them to even give me their time, they want to work on different projects with me because they're so invested into the Iranian market, you know. And I said that from a young age, when Iran has given so much back to me through football, I want to give it back to these young men, you know, like I did for Cat last year and for a recent player of ours, you know. And I think that's more rewarding to me, honestly. And hopefully, I could do it more through law. Than, you know, just sitting at a law firm and just doing work. I've always been someone that I felt like if I've been so privileged to be here where I'm at in this life, I want to give it back to society to a point that hopefully if I have enough money to set up a charity or something. But I think in this life, we should grow as on a daily basis. There's always room for growing. And I've always been somebody that I always want to become a better person from the day before. And I realized that through my work, working with these players, of how I could change. You know, and yeah, it's been a blessing.
It's amazing. So, I was an M&A lawyer, so I did transactions, and some
Okay,
of
so
the very vivid memories I remember are like the night before signing or the night before closing this, and you've worked for like, you know, not just like I've worked on it for 3 months, but they have worked like these founders that started these companies start they have worked on it for years. And I never forget one time I was up late at night with the founder. We're trying to do the spreadsheet of like who gets paid what the next day. And he started telling me his story, and he's like, you know, I was kind of, you know, for me as a young lawyer, I was like, oh my God, like tomorrow you're gonna get so much money or this or that. And he was like, well, for the past like 5 years, me and my founders have been sharing like a loft and the, you know, the pipe. And I remember he's talking about like the hot water pipes are next to the bed, so it's either like super hot or super cold. And there's just such beautiful spiritual moments like that, that it's like right before the sunrise or something and late at night. So I suspect the moments you had with some of these players, and they come from like all over Iran, sometimes small towns, and now you're on the cusp of like signing with a Dutch team or something, and like there's some beautiful moments.
100% Ali. I mean, it's very different for us because these players are considered non-EU. So American players are considered non-EU, meaning that if you want to take them to Europe, you got to look at which leagues they're marketable. And there's only a certain amount of players that are able to slot into that league. So clubs might say, hey, Mr. Hajian, we have, you know, nine players that are EU. We could only accept two more non-EU. You know, and that means American players too. However, it makes our work harder because these players have an Iranian passport. And excuse my language, it's considered terrorism in this day of age. And it's true, you know. And
Tough to track.
so the amount of work we had to do just to get a player of ours his visa and the hurdles and obstacles of, you know, the different cultural differences and stuff to say, hey, Mohammed, you know, you want to make a name for yourself, you know, and to push for him, you know. And I work with some of these players, and you can imagine the people within these clubs are not the most professional people. And these agents within Iran, they're not agents. They're actually, believe it or not, they contact me, taunt me. You know, they realize that somebody is coming to their market and they're taking these players out, and it makes the issue problematic. And when you've seen the world that, like, we have traveled and everything, these players, they come from the toughest areas of Iran. And some people don't understand. Some people would say, why does this player just go straight to Qatar? With this day of age, with this currency issue that we have in Iran, you gotta don't ask yourself why this player's going. Just see where he comes from, and then see maybe he wants to provide back. You get what I'm trying to say? So when I work with these players, you could sign anyone. I could sign like some of the top talent players right now. But when you can't do anything for them, what's the value in it? So we, like what I do is I really make sure that the player's mentality, you could, and I've always said this, and this is for anything you like. It doesn't matter how talented you are. If you don't put any hard work in, if you don't have the mentality, that talent is gone to waste, right? Yeah. So I make sure that the players that we want to work with, not only are they going to make it, they want to make it, but it also is something of, let's put it this way, that we know that if the player goes to Europe, they're not going to call me tomorrow, Pasha Jan, then I'm at a mall, then I'm tank shit. I miss my mother. And these are the cultural differences, is that you're taking a young boy from Iran that hasn't seen the westernized world or might not even speak the language. And I have to mentor these kids. And I'm only a couple of years older than them.
Yeah, and you're one person.
You know, and it's a group of us, thankfully. And when we started this and I met my colleagues through this podcast, and because I helped them off the record with some deals, and then when I'm now in it with them, and they've always seen them as mentors. And as I said, you know, every deal is a new learning experience in itself, you know. And agents today, you know, they have 30 years experience, and they always say, Pasha, you're lucky enough that this is such a short duration that you've been able to break into this market when it's taken us years. And so I take that as, you know, what's the word that I'm looking for? Like, not for granted, I should say, you know. And as you said, Ali, that from a young age right now, maybe when you make a deal, money comes into your head, but that's not the way I work. I said that this is just all a learning experience. But just going back to what you were saying is that to help these youngsters, especially in this day of age with the political climax in Iran, for them to make a name for themselves and for them to be able to have an opportunity outside of Iran that maybe they could be fortunate enough to even live there down the road is very gratifying, you know, as a, you know.
I sorry, you picked up, you're very emotionally intelligent. You picked up, I was trying to think that what you do is also very beautiful because, like, now that I'm a lawyer, I know creating these pathways itself is huge. But like, if there has never been a deal between this club in Iran and like this club in Turkey, like to find the right person in the organization that you submit your thing to follow their procedures, to know their medicals, you know, all this stuff. So once you do it once, now you have a playbook and you kind of, it's not just about that one person even, you're creating these pathways that can affect other people's lives.
Of course, and there is a market that I would say, honestly, Carlos Queros, the last manager of Iran, has opened up that players and coaches, I would say, clubs, I would say specifically, scouts, when they contact me, Pasha, tell us more about the Iranian market. And we start talking to them, they don't know a lot of things. For example, a lot of players, they have to go Sarbazi. And we say, we can't just bring an 18-year-old kid, we got to see whether he's even allowed to leave the country because of that. Whether
Sarbazi's military service for...
Exactly. You know. And those guys, we have so many obstacles, if that makes sense, you know. And a lot of people think like, oh, why don't you go represent, let's say, Paul Pogba. But if you don't know the market, you can't just... I can't just immerse myself in the MLS market. I have contacts there, right? But in order to really strive in football, from what I've realized, is that you got to focus on one market, know the market in Europe, which where these players could go, and then work on yourself. And anything in life, and you know, even in law, you specialize on something that you're very profoundly good at, right? And if you don't feel like you're ready for, let's say, another branch of law that you might not have the, let's say, all the legal aspects of it, you will refer them to somebody else, right? And the same thing, that's what we do, you know? And I've always, one thing that I'm very honestly proud of myself in one aspect is being honest with these players. The amount of lies, you know, and some stuff I've heard even talking to them, it's really upsetting, you know? And it's really grown me as a person, Ali, you know? And, you know, right now being in law school, for me, it's a big opportunity in itself. And people always ask me, so you came to law school because you were an agent? I said, no, I came to law school actually for international law because I got affected by the sanctions, you know, a couple of years ago. And that was a driving force for me, you know. But when I got into the football world, I said that, okay, maybe this is where my passion resides. And hopefully with law, I could do something out of it more, you know. And it's been a really fantastic experience so far.
Wow. Are you willing, comfortable to share your sanction story, or you want to talk about something else?
I'll share it. My father was unfortunately not with us for 3 years of my life. He was in federal prison. And that was the driving force for me to get into Golbezan and, you know, understanding that as an Iranian, you know, I'm very proud of my roots, Ali, you know. And that's when I realized it really changed my life, I should say, you know. And now being at this age and, you know, talking to these players and everything, you know, I started realizing that I've been through a huge obstacle that I was able to overcome. You guys could do it as well. You know, let's do it together, you know. And my biggest goal in life has always been that to tell these players that one day you got to give back. If football has given so much to you, right, one day when you become an age or that you want to retire, you got to become either a coach, either set up your academy, and, you know, give back to these younger players that they're not fortunate enough to be in your shoes. So why don't you bring them into the scene, you know? And, you know, that's how I've been operating. And when players buy into your philosophy of philanthropy of, you know, what you want to do, and that's something for me is more rewarding as opposed to telling them, hey, this is how it gets done. This is how much you're going to be making. That's not the way I work. You know, the way I work is that turning a kid into a man, you know. And with that experience that happened to me, I realized that, you know, there's so much, you know, as an Iranian I could do. You know, and so, you know, here we are today.
Thanks, Pasha John, for sharing that. I love that. I think I talk about this a lot. I've had some tragedies in my life, but the ability to turn that into perspective is actually really, really, really useful. And I lost my brother in 2009, right before law school. And I remember thinking, in a strange way, like as time went on, you forget that perspective because you get bogged down with life again and stress and whatever. And I remember strangely thinking, like, I can't wait for the next like great tragedy to happen to me so I can get that perspective back, because I missed it. Like, I missed being in that zone of like everything was clear, what matters, what doesn't matter, what's BS, what's real. So thanks for sharing that story. People watching, if you have any questions, shout outs, ask Pasha. I have a ton. Pasha John, the last picture you posted on Facebook, which we used for the poster, you signed a female player. So you talked a lot about men. Can you talk to us about women players?
Katayoun Khosrowyar, she used to be the former, she used to be the national team captain of the Iranian national team for women's, but she became a coach. She's actually Iranian American herself. And, you know, through a family friend that we had, she had a story to say, and I realized how much through these obstacles for women's rights, especially in trying to empower them, what she was doing was very gratifying. And there was many people that were contacting her, you know, give us interviews, and she was giving interviews. And one day she asked me, Pasha, can you help me? You know, and I said, help you in what aspect? She goes, to become a better coach, you know. And I said, it's not going to be easy for you, because as much as you're doing so many amazing things outside of Iran, they think on paper, what games have you won? They don't care if your girls were wearing a hijab the whole time in 100 degree, you know. Tehran in Sri Lanka, for example. And I remember at the time, Ali, some of the biggest agents told me there is no possible way you could place this coach, you know, outside of Iran, because it's Iran. And what I mean by that is anything in life is possible if you want to make it possible, right? And I'm pretty sure there was times in your life, Ali, that even unfortunately, and condolences again to you, you know, when you lost your brother, that there was times that there was a huge obstacle for you to see how you could bounce back. And so through CAD, you know, I made sure to market her through a website and everything. And thankfully, last year, she became the first ever female coach to become a coach in the National Women's League from Iran, which is the one of National Women's Soccer League. Olympic Lyon just bought it. So it's actually now all Rain FC. At the time, it was Rain FC. And her life just changed. You know, and a lot of people were shocked, like, how was a coach like that? And that all happened through, as I said, hard work and showing her that, telling these clubs that there's a story for you to share, you know. And as you could imagine, in this world, unfortunately, in soccer world, which is very materialistic, it's when this thing was done, those people I'm not gonna name anyone that used to call me. Now they wanna work with me on different projects, if that makes sense, you know. And so through that, she always calls me. She goes, Pasha, what about this project? I said, Kat, it's very difficult, you know. It's extremely difficult placing players outside of Iran within these leagues. And that has nothing to do more with their talents. It just has to do, unfortunately, with the political climax of the country and, you know, what these clubs want and everything. So it's just a day-to-day case, you know. And I'm fortunate enough to be working with Kat right now, and she has a story to say. So I highly recommend everybody to just look her up. Her name is Katayoun Khosrowyar. And just there's plenty of articles about her. And she's done a fantastic job for fighting for women's rights within, you know, Iran. And she was actually the founder figure to drive the force to, you know, have women attend into the stadium. And she actually was the first person that attended the stadium with all her girls, you know. And to be able to help her and to be with her on this journey just makes me just trying to become more aware, you know, of not only women, but also the obstacles that come with them in any drive force in the workplace, if that makes sense. Now, especially in sports. And so to be able to do that was, you know, something, as I said, I don't take these small things for granted, you know. And there's always room to grow. And so we'll see what happens next.
That's beautiful. I will, Katayoun Khosrowyar, I'll look her up and post the link in the notes. Pasha, so now you're in law school, so like what angle have you found to make your curiosity tick and like to turn your fire on in law school, if that makes sense?
I'm not sure you mean like the classes that I've had.
Yeah, like what aspect of law school do you find exciting and interesting because you already have such a rich background?
I think the most, especially attending Davis Law School, that is extremely diverse school. For me, just being the student, I've always realized that it's not so much the material, but learning from different cultures and the way different people think in different circumstances, right? So if we have two like-minded people in one room, it doesn't get anything far, right? But sitting in this classroom with so many amazing people from different backgrounds, some of the toughest institutions, and unfortunately competing with them, you know, in school, I think that's been the most fantastic experience. Because one thing that I think law school does that shouldn't be happening, but I think just the way the system is, that it teaches you to be competitive, but in this profession, you got to know how to collaborate with one another, right? So I've always tried to, you know, if somebody needs an ally, I'll help them. If there's anything I could do for my own, I'll help them. But just going back to your question, I think the most important thing I've learned about law school is that, or something that, you know, drove me is that, law is always changing and there's always room to grow, and I see that with the football world. But to be honest, I haven't really pinpointed something maybe out of these classes that I've taken out of it, you know. But I think the most rewarding for me thing with law school has just been the different people, different professors from, you know, backgrounds, cases with the Supreme Court, and for that person to just be standing side by side and teaching me this course.
Yeah.
It's kind of cool, if that makes sense,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and
yeah.
To be able to get that knowledge, you know. So I don't really focus on the classes, to be honest. I try to think more about them outside of class and how they could help me grow as a, you know.
Oh, no. We lost student. Pasha again. All right, Pasha, I'll X you out and we'll get you back in for like a final question. But wow, how interesting. Okay. All right, we're adding Pasha back.
Sorry.
No worries. So you were talking about law school, how interesting it is to be in the company of like such amazing people who in their own field, like you in sports agency, like they just fell into it, they followed it, they loved it, they know all the ins and outs of that, they know all the challenges. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, you know, and it's like, I believe you attended NYU, and just being in New York and just the diversity by itself, you know, it's cool, you know, and they're sharing a bit of their culture to you. You're sharing your culture to them, you know, and you're working together as students, and it's cool, you know, it's
yeah,
amazing,
yeah.
You know, and I think that's what I love about Davis. It's so many diverse students that sometimes I'm like, wow. So you see it, and then some of the institutions they come from, I'm like, wow, you know, I got to compete with them on top of work and everything, you know. So it's tough, but it's unfortunate enough to do it.
Yeah, you come from Tehran International School, man. Pasha, what was like one sports star you met that you were starstruck, like that jumps to your mind? You're like, oh my God.
You mean like a player?
Yeah, player, coach, a sports personality where you're like, your heart was beating and you're like, it's so exciting, I'm meeting this person.
I've never met Carlos Queros in person yet, but when Carlos called me himself and we had like a video call, that's when it really touched me, I should say, you know, because it was because of an instant driving force, but because Carlos and what he was doing with these players that nobody was talking about it outside of Iran, you know. Yeah. What is this man doing? Same man that was coaching with Sir Alex Ferguson, Manchester United, his coach in Portugal, Real Madrid, so many diverse countries, right now as head coach of Colombia.
Yeah.
For him to give me a call and thank me, you know, I think that's when it starstruck me, you know.
Yeah, I mean, look one call, like what an impact it left on you. And then he did that times a million for these players day in and day out. Yeah, I remember the way he was like, he got good at Chunezani with like Iranian government and stuff. He would like played their game to get like things for players. And
yeah,
like,
that's how it works in Iran. That's how it works. And
but what a
that's
great leader.
Exactly. And that's something a lot of people don't know is that even with these players, you got to play the game, unfortunately. And so even with these clubs within Iran, you know, they want to keep these players within the system and everything, you know. But I think just going back to what you were saying with Carlos, he actually, when I got the deal done for Cat, he personally called me. He found it through his assistant, you know, and he goes, you became an agent. I mean, how'd you even, you know, and stuff like that, you know, and we spoke and he said, Pasha, you know, come and help these Colombian players out now, you know. And I started laughing, you know, I said, Carlos, you know, I don't speak Spanish, you know, and stuff, but it's really cool for somebody like that I used to watch on TV and I've read books about to be now texting me sometimes here and there, hey Pasha, happy new year, coach, how you doing, you know.
Yeah,
I think that's been pretty my right now starstruck moment.
It's so beautiful. I have a special place for Carlos. I was in New York for the last World Cup, the one before the last, and the Iran-Argentina game. And I was in the Upper West Side bar with like mostly Americans, not Iranians. And I never forget, in the beginning of the game, they were all pro-Argentina. And then as the game progressed, Iran was like doing so well. By the end, when Messi scored that last one, 92nd minute, the entire bar was sad, and it was one of the first times I saw non-Iranian supporting Iran in like a non-threatening way. It was in a beautiful, humanly way, and I just never forget the feeling that day, and it's beautiful. Pasha, how can we help you in the group, in this community, in this platform we've created to push you towards your dreams?
Oh, that's tough. I'm trying to. He caught me off guard with that one. I think that not for me, to be honest, not for me personally, is that I think we should be more aware of what things are happening within Iran, you know. And the reason why I'm saying that is that, you know, unfortunately, with the incident that happened to Navid, the wrestler, as you could imagine, you know, and when they executed him. And the wrestler, you know, people were quickly to say, people were quickly to say, let's sanction Iranian sports and stuff like that. But not realizing that with these sanctions, a lot of people are already struggling within Iran. And these athletes, they really are supporting their families through football, you know. And I think we should be more aware in the sense that, you know, what we want is always not necessarily good for what Iran wants by itself, if that makes sense, you know. And I think that if there's any opportunity to help somebody out, doesn't matter if they're, you know, ethnicities, Iranian, immigration issues with from different diversities, to really, you know, help them, if that makes sense, you know. And that's what I've realized more through the game of football, is that there's so many immigration law issues and there's so many different legal aspects that are impacting the game, you know. And if whoever comes across, you know, your case, Ali, or whoever else, is to be able to give him a lending hand. If you can't do it, give it to somebody else, you know. But I think that's it really for me. If that answered your question, I know it's a little bit broad answer, but
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you for that reminder. We should all do that. For you personally, too, my offer to help you form your company and set up your brand still stands. We have so many awesome people in the group who are willing to help. So, whenever you need any help with any of that, we have a ton of
of
corporate
course. Thank
lawyers,
you.
litigators, whatever you need,
Thank you.
reach out. Thank you for your time, for sharing the message of human love through the soccer ball, sharing your experiences from childhood through Florida to Davis, and where you want to go. That's beautiful, and I'm so happy I got to meet you this summer. Thanks to COVID, like I say.
No, thank you,
Silver
Ali.
linings, right?
Yeah, thank you, Ali, even for taking the time to talk to me this evening, and for the folks that will be watching this, I think that anything in life, ideas become things, right? So even this platform by itself, I think, could immerse people to feel free to share their ideas with different Iranian people from wherever they might be, and to create into a hub that it becomes more of a resource to folks, I should say. And that's what I realized with Gold Bazan and through football, is that you created a hub, and you want to just keep building upon it with different
These are
people.
all
And so I thank you.
excuses. These are all excuses for us to connect. Somewhere around, somewhere on Facebook, it doesn't matter what it is.
No, I
Damn it, Jan,
appreciate
pleasure. And have a fantastic night. You're always
it.
welcome. We're gonna do more parts of this because it's so fascinating and there's so much more
Thank
to
you.
say.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you,
Good
Ali.
luck. Good luck,
You're
brother. Talk
nice to
soon.
touch that
Bye.
good mode.